There you go. You see?
Okay.
What's your dance?
Oh, I don't have one. There's a variety of them, man.
What does it make you feel like doing?
Shake my shoulders a little.
Right, here comes the.
Ah, I see you're a robot guy.
All right. Welcome to Mita Unshackle. We have a very special, our first ever guest for our cultivation segment. I'm Dimitri Downing here with
Destiny Nicole of Mita. I'm Ari Munoz.
And we're very excited. We're here at the ICBC still, introducing you to famous figures in the American cannabis industry, as well as the international cannabis industry. We have a very special guest here today, one of the OGs, and I love saying OGs. OGs from the cannabis industry of the United States of America. Ali is here with us from Sunset Connect. How are you doing?
Good. Thanks for having me, Dimitri. Thanks for having me, guys. It's good to be here.
Ali, you have been in the cannabis industry your whole life.
Pretty much since I was 18, yes.
Your whole life. How did it start?
Well, it started with the necessity to pay for college. And that moved quickly into a passion for the plant. And everything else is really history. We started growing in college. In the late 90s. Unfortunately, I was busted by the federal government in 99 and paroled and almost deported, which now, in hindsight, you know, 20 years later, got me the status of San Francisco's first social equity manufacturer and distributor.
Nice.
See, we have somebody famous here. San Francisco's first ever. What year was that?
Well, the first, we reopened our doors in 2020. It took me about 3 years to build out my manufacturing facility to spec, which is kind of also why I'm here, because having walked that path of legalization and seeing how difficult it was for a bootstrap legacy operator to come online really motivated me to be an advocate, to run for the position of the chairman of the Cannabis Oversight Committee of San Francisco. So now I serve as the chair.
Not just famous, but important.
It's important that the industry has a seat at the table to bridge the gap between what legislators think we do and what we actually do, right? So that's what really helps. And San Francisco is unique in the way that we have 8 operators and 8 city department heads that sit on this committee. And we work on changing legislation from building code to health code to really like lower the barrier for people to be able to get their business off the ground.
You know, regulation is everything, and every jurisdiction is unique. You just established yourself as our San Francisco expert, by the way.
that's fine. I'm happy to be here.
It's just how it is around here. 97, 2020, 23 years, you were legacy growing?
Yes. So, well, after I got paroled, I took a 4 or 5 year break. I was pretty traumatized, and, you know, nobody wanted to live with me when the feds can come and knock on your door without a warrant at any given point. Yep. So after that, I took a little bit of a break. I think I was finished in 2006 to 2011. I sat out. I saw that the medical...
Wait, it wouldn't be a parole violation to admit that you weren't sitting out by...
No, I know that. I know that.
You're good.
Dimitri.
No, it's just, I'm good looking out,
Instigator.
Dimitri.
Good looking just out.
it's too late at this point.
So in 2010, 11, I went back in full time, and we quickly started supplying San Francisco dispensaries with high-grade flower, but also with really good homemade hash, edibles, and other... manufactured products.
This is I love interviewing people like you. I mean, because we have ancillary auxiliary section, we have retail, we have cultivation, we have manufacturing, and then within cultivation, we have the subcategories of the commercial large scale grower and the OG who managed to come in. So eventually, it will be all mostly commercial. And
I think we're pretty craft. I think we'll always be pretty craft. You know, for me, I always say I care mostly what the San Francisco smoker wants. San Francisco is sort of the Napa of cannabis. So
yeah.
We set really strong trends. If your local market is like San Francisco, embraces a product, you have a good chance of selling that product California-wide or worldwide, right?
I'm rooting for craft, man. I mean, the craft are like the artists of the industry.
Right. Well, it's the intent that you go to production with. The intent of a corporate cannabis outfit, and it's fine, is to get the most dollars out of their square footage and make their balance sheets look good.
Right.
When we process product, our intent, because we are cultivators and our own biggest customers probably, is just to come up and make the dankest product we can possibly
quality
make.
Over quantity.
And geeking out with the with the material, right? When we were very, very lucky to make Frenchie Cannoli's last run of hash with him. We're really blessed to have him in our facility. But we also saw the intent with which Frenchie approached things, and it made us almost look corporate. But we really learned a lot about just looking at the plant and at its trim and at its smalls and at its bigs and then deciding what should be done with that, right?
Exactly.
And I feel like that's sort of our recipe to success when it comes to pre-rolls. Our pre-rolls have exploded in the Bay Area market over the last 6-7 months.
Your pre-rolls are pure flower, not trim?
Well, we have several. So we have one that we felt that prices at dispensaries were becoming really unapproachable for blue-collared workers. So we decided to do a 1 gram sugar trim indoor pre-roll that sells for $5 retail, including tax.
Nice.
But it tests at 25 to 30%.
Sugar pre-roll, does that mean concentrates you add
to
it?
No, it's actually just really high-end trim with zero water leaves, right? And our separation process, we process, to his point, Kraft is processing in small batches. We grind 150 grams at a time. We look across right there at the Futurola, which is one of my suppliers, and I love them. But I would never buy a grinder from them because I'm not throwing 3 kilos in a grinder.
That's our ICBC rave over there. It's happening over there.
So it's the intent with which we approach manufacturing and cultivation. In cultivation, my team and I are lucky to have combined experience of 60 years and having run so many strains that at this point we really know what we're looking for in a strain. But we are trying to get to a level where I always say we want to be an anchor steam, where you're getting a craft product at a commercial scale.
So do you guys have all like the same kind of strains that you keep reproducing, or do you guys go and pheno hunt different kind of strains for all your products?
Both. We definitely have a vault that we're really comfortable with. Lamb's Breath is one of them. We have the original Lamb's Breath.
I haven't heard Lamb's Breath.
Oh, whoa.
We it's not been on the market because we're building out our cultivation facility at the moment.
Holding it.
But Lamb's Breath will definitely be back. Dosey Pie is one of our strains, which is a cross of Dosey Dough and Velvet Pie. And then what we're releasing next is actually, huge shout out to Compound Genetics, a gummies that we took from Compound on a pheno hunt, and we crossed it with our Irish Cannonball.
You guys should have a tiger's tail. If you're going to have a lamb's breath, you need a tiger's tail.
Compound lends itself to a tiger's tail, right?
There we go.
But, the lucky thing about living in San Francisco is the Compound guys are there. Mario Sharbinski is there. The Cookie guys are there. Mm-hmm. And then they all come from the Sunset District, right? Mm-hmm. That's kind of why we're Sunset Kids. That's also why the company is named the Sunset Connect. We've known.
I think that's the first time you've mentioned the company's name.
The Sunset
Connect. Sunset Connect, yeah.
So that's kind of, it's really fortunate to be living somewhere where you have this strong of an ecosystem.
The OGs are about the plant, not the commercialization of it. That's
community.
What I like. Yeah.
Yeah, community is big. Community is actually the most important because that's what kept us out of jail for so long.
Right.
So if people are looking to collaborate with you or get to know your product a little bit more,
yeah,
Mind
hit us
you.
Up on Instagram at Sunset Connect. We have tons of collabs all the time.
At Sunset Connect?
Yeah.
At LinkedIn as well?
No, I don't think we're on LinkedIn.
You should get on there.
I'm on LinkedIn, Ali Jamali, and you can look me up. But if you hit us up at Sunset Connect, we do, to your point with communities, we always have a community-based collaboration at any given point. We did United Players, which is a gun violence prevention group in San Francisco. We did a line with them, 50% of the profits go to them. Currently, we have a line with a Children's Athletic Development Foundation. They go and they render services to inner city schools that otherwise only private schools have for their athletes. And we developed a topical with them, and the Golden State Warriors supported, and 50% of the sale of that also goes to the community-based organization.
That's awesome.
So we always have something like that going.
Are you guys heading down to Southern California as well? Or?
Yeah, we're available in SoCal. We're available at Steezy. Steezy's been a really big supporter of us.
Shout out Steezy.
Yep, Steezy Cookies has always been a good supporter. We just launched a collaboration with a gentleman named Corvain Cooper. He was really, he had life in prison for cannabis, and he got pardoned. So
Sounds
we just launched Yeah, 40 tons.
Yep.
So we're a 40 tons manufacturing partner.
Okay, yeah, we just, all around.
I told you, we're famous, we just launched
with 40 tons. So that'll really open the Southern California market for
dropping in here at ICBC. What's next after California? What do you think? You're going to wait for interstate commerce? Or you going to migrate?
I'm with you on interstate commerce. I really hope that because the way it has to happen is if wine can get exported from Napa to New York, why can't we? You know, our craft brew goes zigzag across the country. So
yep.
I don't see why it shouldn't.
It's one of the things Mita USA is trying to do is educate members of the industry of not just how the industry works, but how the industry should work. And we really want people to understand the importance of advocating for interstate commerce.
Yes.
There are people in the industry who might want to protect their own interests
mm-hmm.
and not push for interstate commerce. But as soon as we get interstate commerce going, the brands can migrate across the states and the best will survive. That's okay. And most importantly, the consumers and patients will have a choice. And that's what we want to fight for.
I agree. I totally agree. It's really giving them the choice. And if you look at I think the advocacy part of it should come for small business. Because if you allow interstate transport, you are giving small business a lifeline.
Mm-hmm.
As you know right now, the ones that have vested interest in other states have coffers of VC money. So they're just buying that shelf space right now, right? But if you give interstate commerce a chance, then the craft grower from Humboldt, Moon Made Farms, big shout out to Tina. You could get Tina's weed over there, right? That would be awesome.
I met her at MGM Packed.
Oh, I love Tina.
I like her. Yeah.
Big shout out to Tina.
Are you going to MGM Packed in Vegas?
Yeah, I'll see you there.
I will see you there.
All right.
So, you know, thank you for being our first cultivator guest. And, you know, if people want to get a hold of you and collaborate with you.
Yeah, hit me up at Sunset Connect.
Thanks very much. Appreciate it.
Great to be here. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, girls. It was really nice to be here.
Thank you. It was so nice to meet you.